I have a passion. And let's just go back to the home slide. He's got passion. Jesus has got passion. St. Paul has passion and zeal for his house. I begin my sermon with a question for you today. What are you passionate about? What is there is that keeps you awake at night that you think about, I'm driven by this. I want to do this and I want to do it well. What would you make a sacrifice for? We don't sacrifice a lot. We do stuff. I want to grow. I want to learn. But the Christian gospel calls you actually to sacrificial giving life your very being. And our scriptures are full of people of great sacrifice. And that's what I want you to kind of think about. I know that I have a passion for golf. I wish I could play a better game. I'm not talking about that. Maybe your passion is music, and you want to be able to play a musical instrument better. Okay, unless you're a professional musician, but I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about not hobbies, but your life career. What is it that might give you passion? Is it the... I came across a woman who had a passion, and I thought it was a very godly thing. And it was the education of her children. His zeal for this issue. I used to teach at Ridley College years ago. And generally speaking, the people who send their students to a private school like Ridley College generally have a fair bit of money. Tuition was $30,000 back in the 80s. I mean, it was a lot of money. Okay? And... early 90s. And that being said, there was a lot of people who, what I might just call good old normal folk like myself, who were there. And I remember this one woman who did a morning paper route to save money to send her kid to Ridley. That's passion. That's zealous. That's commitment. That's sacrificial. And I think God actually smiles on that kind of attitude. And I wonder what it is that we have. The scripture of today, John 2, 17, says Jesus had zeal for your house shall consume me. We're going to touch on that in a moment, but their zeal, Oxford Dictionary describes it as an earnest and healthy fervor for service or the advancement of a cause. Eugene Ormandy, director of the Philadelphia Philharmonic, okay, Eugene Ormandy, blew out a shoulder conducting. Now that's zealous, isn't it? I mean, whoa, threw out his shoulder. Here's the problem, I think. We're all Anglicans. And Anglicans show reserve. I mean, we're not way out there. We've got that British reserve. Now, you may not be English, but you're in an Anglican. There's a certain propriety. We don't like to just kind of get out there. And I'm wondering if that's a good thing. So I came across the story. I think it comes across that it's okay to be zealous if it's you, but not me. It's okay to be zealous if it's out there instead of here. The streets were lined with cheering crowds, cheering the marching regiments about to leave for overseas. A recruit who had watched the crowd for some time asked, "Who are all these people cheering?" And the veteran replied, "Those who are not going to war." Such wisdom, eh? I mean, if you're going to war, there's a reserve, but you're actually doing it. And we cheer. What is it that drives you? What is it that you're passionate about? Because I believe that that is the essence of a healthy life. Talking to the kids in confirmation class, we've got some teenagers that we're taking through that. And I tell them that it's important to know your gifts, to know yourself, and where your gifts are here and where the world's needs are here. You put the two of those together and then you've got ministry. See, the problem is that people think that I went into ministry because I'm an ordained cleric. And I'm concerned about that, to recognize, yes, that's fine, but you are called to ministry. And where your gifts are and the world's needs are and where they come together is where ministry happens. It doesn't have to happen here in the church. And so what is your gift? Like, I think I do get envious when I hear about doctors doing things. And so the needs of the world are so clear. And being a doctor, nurse, a health caregiver, to me, just such a wonderful fit. And I think God smiles on that. Some of you may know Blake Woodside from the choir, who's not here today, and Ann Curtis. Their 26-year-old son, Malcolm, had a heart problem. He blew a valve in his heart this last week. And he was visiting his girlfriend in London, Ontario. And I got permission from Blake to tell you this. And we've had one heck of a week. And he could not be transported to Toronto. He was so unstable. And they couldn't operate, his blood levels weren't right, and they had to walk through that. And you can guarantee that Blake and Anne have been sweating bullets, wondering what was going to happen to their 26-year-old, thoughtfully healthy son is all of a sudden really on the razor's edge, and it was quite serious. And no better place to probably get sick than University Hospital London, Ontario, because that's where the heart surgery was, and they had to go ahead with surgery. They could not transport him to Toronto. He was that unstable. A full day of surgery, and they made it. So thanks be to God, and it was a long, long day. But I have to tell you something. I was praying for the doctor, and I was going, Lord, this is his ministry. This man is gifted, and he's doing this. It's so important when these things come together. What's your ministry? Where do you serve in the world? Where do you serve the kingdom of God? And that's where your zeal, I think, needs to happen, because God's given you these things. Maybe it's administration, and maybe you're not a doctor. Maybe you're into technology. I had one young man come to me, and he says, I love words. I'd like to be an English major. I'd like to do a doctorate in English, but there's just no point in doing it. And I said, of course there's no point in doing it. It's the most useless degree in the world. Don't do it. Can you imagine me saying that? No, not really. I didn't say that to him. I said, my gosh, you were gifted with words. Now take that skill, that gift you've got, and develop it, because the world needs communicators. That needs people who know how to write and know how to think. And it may not be quite as first glance as glamorous as a doctor, but my goodness, it's important. And it's part of what makes this body of Christ. It's part of what makes us all. Am I coming across too zealous for you? I don't know. I just want no more than usual, right? So we need caregivers. We need people who will serve. It is Women's Rights Day today. There are issues and crises about women in the world, and slavery, and more prostitution going on, girls being brought into prostitution. You know the stories. And I was in another church where we did a mission, and we set up a school for girls. You see, because the congregation was zealous about this. What are you zealous for? And that's what we need to do. What about parenting? It doesn't sound like a lot, but my goodness, without good parenting, we're in a crisis mode. We need to develop people in their fullness. I came across an article, I think it's highly relevant. Post, Jihad on Campus. This is in the city of London, England. This is the University of Westminster, which is a hotbed, quote unquote, hotbed of extremist activity. And it's where these young ISIS kids come from and things like that. The man in this picture had been a terrorist. And now he's turned his life around. And now he's in an advocate for the opposite, counter-extremism. I was born and raised in Essex, just outside London, to a financially comfortable, well-educated Pakistani home. Guess what? Osama bin Laden went to Cambridge. So here's part of the lie. Education will serve the world's problems. I am all for education. We need to be educated. We need to do it. But it is not enough. It's where we need to integrate. And this is why confirmation class is important, Gabby. And this is why we all do it. Is that we learn how to integrate all this knowledge. What did this man say? This is hugely profound. It's back to my point about being a good parent. You're a parent. You need to be doing this. Here's the line. But I lacked the emotional maturity to process these things, end quote. You see, it's not about just data. It's not just about education. Open up your Bible. I'm sure you got that memorized. It's the ability to integrate it. And that's what Good and Beautiful Life is. That's all the stuff that we're doing. These are the things that should be shaping us. And we as a church are in a place to be ministering to others. And that's why, following today's service, we have a vestry meeting. Because the vision is for this third wing to be an education center to the diocese, therefore to the city of Toronto. And we on Thursday, myself and your wardens, are going to be presented into the Daniel's Lion's Den, and it's going to be hot, okay? And I got to build a case for $3 million gift. Please give me $3 million for the vision of what can be. Because I have zeal for the house of God. And so did the leadership of this church. So did Jesus. So did St. Paul. And the question is, do you? So I'm asking you to be praying this day. And today, Brian will pray for it. But I want you to remember Thursday afternoon, and I want you on your knees. We meet at 4 o'clock. And Catherine Bryant, you did amazing work for us, preparing all that stuff and all the paperwork behind it. And thus it goes to the diocese. I live in faith that it'll happen. I don't know. Because we have people who come who want to utilize this wonderful facility that we have. Then they come and look at our third wing, our wing over there, and they go, thanks, but no thanks. And then they leave. There's a revenue source here. There's opportunities. It's a ministry of the wider place. We need to be making ministry. Where your gift is and the needs of the world come together, there is your ministry. Because if you're not living there, then what happens is it becomes a job. And I come across people who've got a job and they're dying. I got to get to work again today and they don't really care and they're logging time. But when you recognize a ministry, a joy comes. I know some people have the ability to make money. I love that. I love people who've got that ability. I look at people who are entrepreneurial. And I go, what a great gift. But if it is for the reason of just making money, go home. If it's just for the reason of making more and more profits, because your ego is so attached to it, then we have a problem. And I think there's a lot of that going on in the culture. But if you're able to be entrepreneurial and then take those resources, because money becomes a vehicle to do good. And that's what God has called us to be. It is that wider view of making ministry. And that's what Jesus encountered when he entered the temple. And here he is, throwing the money changers over. I mean, this is serious stuff. This isn't Jesus loves you, yes, I know. I mean, this isn't soft, mellow little stuff. This is Jesus walking into the temple, and he's, so if you're living in that time, and you're going to make an offering to the temple, to the church, as it were, you can't use Roman coins, because Roman coins are Gentile. They're unclean. Therefore, we need to have the money exchanged. Thus, the money changers. Okay? We buy it at this, we sell it at that, and somebody's making a profit, and they're even making profit in the sacred temple. And Jesus has a righteous anger. What's your zeal? Doesn't look too Anglican to me, because I'm not sure we would do that. But there was Jesus sitting over in the corner. I can just see it. And people are worshiping. And there he is. It's premeditated anger. It is right. Jesus did not sin. That's not sinning. He came into the sanctuary and he thought about it and he makes a whip. And I think what's going on is he's just fuming inside. He's just creeping up. And he overthrows it all and he says, you've turned my house into a marketplace. It's meant to be a house of prayer, a place of ministry. And then the disciples remembered, oh yes, zeal for your house shall consume me. Here's the piece that I think we get caught in. Do you have zeal for church? Do you have zeal for the house of God? You see, I think the trend is, I can be zealous for God or the Holy Spirit. I'm right in the Holy Spirit. I'm all for Jesus, and we talk about that. When we do the creeds, I believe in Father, Son, Holy Spirit. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. Isn't it interesting that the church made the creed? One, a Catholic faith. The church matters. I want you to leave today with a high view of church, because it is God's way, whether we like it or not. And it's so easy. I mean, I'm so against the institution, it just drives me crazy. And yet, this institution called the church and our bishops and those in authority are there, are placed with the responsibility of making sure that this place is safe. It is a good thing. Thus, I leave you. I want to kind of wrap up today in a shorter sermon, but I do want to turn to Ephesians 3, 1-10. I want you to think, did Drew just leave Acts of the Apostles? Because we've been doing this series, and I said in the preface, but this is so Acts of the Apostles. So if you could open your Bible and take a look at it, but because I think you learn more by just opening the scripture and looking at it. Ephesians chapter 3 of the Pew Bibles, page 149. But because now you are so learned, especially after the last two sermons, last 2 weeks, about what went on in Acts 9 and 10, Acts 9 was the conversion of St. Paul. And Acts 10 is that story of Cornelius and St. Peter, and how this message, all things are clean. Now, it's not just the Jewish people, but it's the whole world. It includes the Gentiles. It was radical. Last week, I was pointing out how radical this story was to Peter. Verse 1, chapter 3, Ephesians. This is the reason I, Paul, am a prisoner. He's so zealous. He's a prisoner for Christ Jesus. Was he in Rome in prison when he wrote it? Possibly. But I also think there's a spiritual point. For the sake of you Gentiles, see? For surely you've already heard of the commission of God's grace that was given me for you, and how the mystery, Ephesus is in Turkey, and the people here are not primarily Jewish, okay, to the audience. So, and I wrote above in a few words, verse 4, a reading of which will enable you to perceive my understanding of the mystery of Christ. See, people on the outside of the church do not understand Christ. People who reject Christ more often than not do not know who Christ really is. In former generations, i.e. the Jewish Old Testament, verse 5, this mystery was not made known to humankind. We just didn't know it. As it has now been revealed to his holy apostles, prophets by the Spirit. It was revealed to Paul in Acts chapter 9. That's what we just studied. That is verse 6, that the Gentiles have become fellow heirs, members of the same body, and shares in the promise of Christ Jesus through the gospel. Verse 7, of this gospel I have become a servant according to the gift. The line I want you to grab is in verse 10. So that although that through the church, the wisdom of God in its rich variety might now be made known. It's meant to happen through the church. Now, you may not like church, and church isn't this building, as you well know. It's you and me gathered. But we are called to worship. We are called to be the people of God. And I want you, during Lent, to not just think about your own personal spiritual walk, but where is your sacrifice? Where is your passion? And how does that fit into the work of the church of God, that other people may grow? So I'm going to ask Brian to come up, and Monique, if you could come up and prepare our hearts for prayer. I am mindful that the world needs, the problem I have is that so few people seem to care about the church. And I want you to have that care. And so today we pray for the work that we do here at St. John's, and possibly what the diocese might be able to do with all of us here, and this great opportunity of St. John's here in the north end of the city. God bless you.